Welcome to our continued Bible study where we're discussing the liturgy. And today we get to look at the Kyrie, the salutation, the collect, and the readings. Now, it seems like a lot, and we do have a lot to talk about, but they fall in together and they make this interesting transition, and we get to hear and see our interaction with God. So first of all, we're looking at the Divine Service Setting 1, and on page 152 in the Lutheran Service Book, we have the statement or the subtitle, Kyrie, and then it's translated for us, Lord have mercy. And I really like this imagery of this. So the assistant or the pastor, in mercy let us pray to the Lord. And then the congregation responds, Lord have mercy. For the peace from above, Lord have mercy. For this holy house, Lord have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy.
So what you were saying is Kyrie eleison.
Yes.
This is Greek, and the Kyrie means Lord. So we are addressing God through this. This is a prayer, but it might not be a prayer for what you think. Growing up, I heard, you know, Lord have mercy, and I thought a lot about like the confession and absolution, where we're asking God to have mercy on us, you know, for our sins, to forgive us our sins. And actually, that's not what the Kyrie is about. Remember, the confession and absolution already happened. Right. We're not asking God to have mercy on us, to forgive us. We're actually asking for something different.
And I really like this because we've entered into the chancel through the introit, and now we're making a statement. And this is really a scary statement. We're making these, we hear in peace, let us pray to the Lord, and we say, Lord, have mercy. And we're really saying, God, you promised you would do this. And in expectation, we are here. You have mercy. We know where the mercy is, and you promise to act this way, merciful. Lord, have mercy. It's, as Vicar was saying, it's not the cowering, scared, have mercy, don't smite us, do not wipe us into oblivion, but it's we're here in your mercy. We're right here so you'll deal with us in your mercy.
We're not contrite here, we're bold.
Yes. And I really like that focus and that idea because it changes. And when we think about this, just the awkwardness of what do you do in worship? We're worshiping God, of course. But is this an action? Is this a feeling? Is this just words? And the idea that you are addressing your Creator, the one who has just forgiven you, the one that you're praising, but now you're addressing him according to what he has said. You're almost throwing his words back at him. And this is one of the things that I really do love about the liturgy. We don't make this up. We don't find platitudes to tell God, but we do speak his word back to him.
We hold him to his promises.
Yes.
And God actually wants us to do this.
Right.
Moses does this
again,
for the Israelites,
and again, yeah,
again and again and again. This happens with Jesus. We hold God to his promises because he is always faithful to his word. And so his promises become this thing that we can rely on and count on. And so here in the Kyrie, we're asking God to remember his promises and to make them true for us in the world.
And especially during this situation in the divine service,
mm-hmm,
where we're receiving God and we're asking him in this relationship, in this promise. And it's beautiful. And I really do like the boldness,
yeah,
of holding God to his promises. When we're the ones who are unfaithful,
yeah,
and breaking everything, we come to God and say, you said so.
Yeah.
And I love what he does. Yes, here it is.
Lord have mercy.
Again and again. And then we move into the salutation.
Now, sometimes there is a Gloria.
Right, the hymn of praise.
Yes, and we won't be talking about that here. It's not in every church season.
Right.
But in our service, there is sometimes a Gloria between the Kyrie and the salutation. And like you said, it's a hymn of praise.
Right. So the salutation, this is when the pastor will turn from the altar after speaking or chanting the Kyrie, and he will address the congregation, and his hands will go out, and he will say, "The Lord be with you." I love this statement because it's not coming from the pastor. It's not him doing anything. He's actually making a statement and almost a question. And it is, "The Lord be with you." And the congregation responds, "Also with you." This is a question, a statement. Are we still together in the same spirit, confession, and worship? Are we, pastor and congregation, are we together? And I've mentioned this before in Bible classes and individuals, and I have no problem saying that there's this little fear in the back of my head to turn around one Sunday and say, "The Lord be with you," and nothing happens. I don't think it'll ever happen.
Seems unlikely.
Right. But this is, I really like this. This is a built-in protection of the liturgy, that the relationship of pastor and congregation are together, that the congregation understands what the pastor is doing, and the pastor understands what the congregation is doing. This is the receiving, hearing, speaking, and delivering of God's word. And if you don't trust the pastor, or the pastor's doing something wrong, or even the congregation is doing something wrong, this is the point of the worship service, that is to stop and address what the issue is. And it doesn't have to be like a public drag out airing of the laundry. But if we're not together, pastor, congregation, there's bigger situations, and those need to be addressed. Because then how can we approach God in his mercy when we're not together, and to receive what God gives?
I think this is probably one of my favorite parts of the liturgy.
Really?
Just these few, very, very few words. It's one of the shortest pieces, mm-hmm. in our worship practice. But I think I like it so much because this is that point of connection between the pastor and the congregation. And this really is a chance also for the pastor and the church to extend hospitality, to, with open arms, welcome people into this divine reality that we are participating in.
Yeah.
And also, like you said, to speak back to your pastor as well. I think this is a very personal element. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it's not just the pastor speaking these words, but this really is one of the places where I think the pastor is their most human.
Yeah, well, I would absolutely agree. Because this is one of the things that I love, not only with the arms open, "The Lord be with you," but when it's spoken and also with you, you'll see my hands come together and I bow. And it's the idea that I'm submitting to the congregation. Yes, we're together. And yes, I will continue to lead and continue to deliver the gifts of God. I'll continue to do my job. And it's not a silly thing. It's, yes, well, absolutely.
Now, this brings up an interesting point. Both of these actually do. Because it brings up an interesting point about ritual.
Yeah.
Both the Kyrie and the salutation. What do these rituals do to us? And what happens when we understand them? So, for example, with the Kyrie, how has singing the Kyrie formed you in your life? How has experiencing the salutation formed you in your life? How are these rituals that we're doing acting upon you?
Yeah. For me, I've always loved the idea, especially after I learned the Lord have mercy wasn't cowering before God, but boldly speaking to God and expecting his promises. This changed the idea of what the divine service is all about.
Right.
In the simple sense, I'm coming to where God has promised to act. And it's not just because I said the right words or stood in the right place. It's because he is steadfast.
Right.
And especially the salutation, because even the times that I allow you to do it, and I want you to know, that's one of my favorite parts. But even when you're in the chancel, when you say, "The Lord be with you," the idea when I say, "Also with you," my hands go out. And it is that connection. You're leading me to the altar. You're taking the whole congregation with you for the prayer. And I like that intimate connection, because that should be carried out in the rest of the week with your brothers and sisters, with your pastor. We're in this together, not in the COVID cliche way, but we're in this church, this confession, this faith, this life together.
And where do we go together?
We go to the altar.
Prayer.
Yeah, altar and prayer.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what the collect is. The collect is the prayer of the church. And this changes every Sunday. They're written out, and it is to reflect the major theme of the readings or the day. So, of course, Pentecost would be about the giving of the Holy Spirit. If there's a commemoration or a saint, you might hear the blessing of having this saint in Scripture to reveal Christ.
Pay attention to these. They're quite good, actually.
Yeah.
I think the collects are some of the most well-written prayers. So pay attention to those, or tear them out, or take them home. I think those collects are consistently really good prayers, not just personal prayers, but prayers of the church.
Right. And I when I do visits, I always really like to pray the collect of the week, because if the person in the hospital or at home has missed church, to pray with them the prayer that was prayed in the church. Again, this is connection. This is what we do, and this is where we go. And then it goes into the readings. And you would think the readings are self-explanatory. Of course, we would do the Old Testament. Of course, we do the gospel and the epistle. And what I love about this is you really do get the full narrative of the Bible scrunched together in these little readings. You get the Old Testament, which is usually from one of the prophets, but it's all about promise. It's all about what is coming. And then you have the epistle, which I think is interesting, because I think it should, if somebody asked me, I think it should come after the gospel.
Yeah.
Only because you got the...
Because that's how it is laid out in the Bible.
Yeah, exactly. Consistency. But you got the Old Testament, so you got the promise of Jesus coming. Then you have the gospel, so one of the four gospels. Now he has come. And then you got the epistles, where that's the application of the promise fulfilled in Christ for your life.
And yeah. So,
but again, that's me. I like where it's in the middle, because then you have the promise, then you have the application of the gospel, and then you have the giving of the gospel.
And these readings come from something called the lectionary, which is just a collection of readings that have been put together for the church to read. The lectionary that we use is also used by a lot of other church bodies, as well as a lot of other Lutheran churches, although it's not the only lectionary that is. But the point of any lectionary is to put Old Testament epistle, gospel readings together, or with the original historical liturgy. I think there wasn't Old Testament originally. I think those were added in later. But the point is to put these readings together and then to have the church go through them again and again and again, to go through the story of Scripture, to experience the story of Scripture, to be brought into the story of Scripture. And the lectionary does not cover everything.
No,
it is not a Bible in 1 year kind of thing. Yeah. That's not actually its point. And that's actually one of the reasons you should be in your Bible in your own personal time, because there's actually a lot of stuff that isn't covered by the lectionary. But the lectionary is designed to bring us into the story.
Right. And this is a practical thing that I always like to point out with the lectionary. It actually protects you from me. Because when you have these assigned readings, and the church, the pastor, individual congregations, they're not forced to use the lectionary.
No.
But it really does, as the vicar said, it brings you into the story of salvation. You really do get to hear this in the season. Where do I hear a lot of miracles? Where do I hear a lot of Jesus' teachings? Because we're in the season of Pentecost, and this is all about the building of the church and the joys of what we have in the church. Easter is all about the resurrection. Advent's all about the preparation for Jesus, so on. And so you get to see this ebb and flow of the narrative of your salvation story. And the reason I say that this protects you is you don't have to worry about me getting on a soapbox and finding some scripture that I want to talk about and then hearing the same sermon with different verses or whatever thing I want to talk about. It really puts the church in the situation to hear scripture. And all the readings, there's so much to preach. There's no way that we'll ever run out of material or things to talk about, no matter how long I live or how many sermons I write. The Bible is fully rich of God's blessings. So I like the idea, again, that it protects the church from the pastor. Preach the lectionary. Preach what is given to be read. And again, it's because we, the church, have bound ourselves to this.
Right. And it means that we're not picking the verses each week, like you said, to deal with our particular hobby horses or soapboxes. We're following a pattern, and thus we get to approach the verses and not say, well, why did I choose this? And instead, we just encounter them and say, how can I faithfully proclaim Christ through this?
Right. And I also like the idea that this connects us to other Christians. As you said, other denominations. I know the Roman Catholics, by and large, use the same text.
Many of the Reformed churches as well also use the lectionary that we use.
So we have this connection. And I like that idea that we're hearing the same gospel read, and we still hear Jesus proclaimed.
Yeah.
Well, if you have any questions about the Kyrie, the salutation, and the collect, and the readings, don't hesitate to shoot out an email or leave a comment, and we'll plug away with the liturgy until the benediction. Or wait, is the benediction the end, or is it the closing hymn?
I consider probably the benediction would be the final note, I think.
Okay, so we'll go all the way to the benediction. God's peace and blessings.